Amen. What an uplifting anthem today. Thank you so much. Think how much that adds to my experience in worship. Those wonderful songs. It's uplifting right before you preach. It's good to be lifted up in that way. Our scripture reading today comes from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4, verses 10 through 13. And Paul writes to them, "I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last you have received revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned for me, but you hadn't had the opportunity to show it. Not that I'm referring to being in need, for I have learned to be content in whatever I have. I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and going hungry, of having plenty and being in need. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me." May God add His blessing to the reading of this word. Well, let me tell you about the way it should be, and the way I certainly hope it is for you when it comes to moments of giving in your life. Maybe it's like this, Commitment Sunday, and you have taken time to prayerfully think about what you want to, your estimate of giving for the coming year, and written it out, and you have placed it in a basket, or you've mailed it to the church, and dropped it by the office. And then after you have done that, you can check that off your list, a great sense of contentment comes over you. Having accomplished that, having done that, having given an estimate of giving for the next year, you feel that contentment. Or maybe it's this way. Each Sunday that you come here, you put your check or your cash or whatever it may be into the offering plate. And having done that, and having us all pray together over the offering that we've given, a great sense of contentment over that offering, and that act of giving. Or maybe it happens at home. Maybe there is some great organization that you love and support. For instance, I know many of you support the Heifer Project. And so you sit down and you write a check for the Heifer Project and you send it away and you feel a great sense of contentment come upon you. This is the way it should be. And yet how often it isn't that way. How often we let some circumstance of life rob us of that sense of contentment in our giving. And it's not just our giving. In any aspect of life, we can lose, or we can gain, if we choose, a sense of contentment, a sense of peace. But we also tend to, over and over in different areas, lose that sense of contentment. We have it robbed and taken from us. And not just in our giving, it could be in our relationships. We should feel content in the relationships that we have. Our parents, with our children, with our brothers and sisters, with friends, with fellow church people, church friends. We should have a great sense of contentment in the relationships we have. And yet often that is robbed from us. We aren't contented in our relationships. And we do not have something that actually God promises to us. Robbed of our contentment. It can happen at work. We can, if we play our cards right, if we so choose, leave our work at the end of the day and feel a profound sense of contentment. And yet, how often we leave work at the end of the day and we feel just the opposite. We feel discontented. We have let, somehow, our contentment be taken from us. It can even be true in our leisure. The things we choose to do for leisure activities. It reminds me of the old expression that we've heard for many years now, that we're out and we're doing something that's supposed to be fun. We're on a vacation that's supposed to be fun. We're doing some activity that's supposed to be fun, and we think in our heads, so are we having fun yet? Are we having fun yet? This is supposed to be an activity that I enjoy, that brings me contentment, and yet that contentment is being robbed and taken away from me. How ironic that we have a hard time with contentment, especially us here, Christian folk, because contentment is something that we are promised. It's a wonderful verse from Philippians that Paul wrote to that church, talking about the contentment that he feels. And he wasn't just reporting about himself. He wasn't just saying, oh, look at me and what I've accomplished and how I feel in my life. He is showing and telling them that this is a promise of our faith, to have this ability to be contented no matter what our circumstances. Paul often talks about his hardships at different times in his letters. He will speak about what he has to go through and how difficult it is. And here we have him saying, you know, through all the ups and all the downs, through the hunger and the plenty, through it all, I have learned to be contented. For I can do all things through him who strengthens me. See, Paul didn't just talk about being contented. He lived it. He did it. I have to tell you, I'd love to be preaching this from the side or from the position of a person who, like Paul, has learned to be content in all things. I have to tell you, this is a journey that I am still on. This is something I still work on every day. I think about that, especially in time off and time away. I think about, instead of thinking about all the being contented with where I am and what I'm doing, thinking and worrying about all that hasn't been done, all that needs to be done, and losing that sense of contentment, letting it be taken away from me. But we need this lesson. We need this lesson here and now. We need it today. We need it here on the 1st of November, this day when we are beginning to think about the holiday season that's ahead and all the work that that entails for many of us, and the hassles and other things and decisions that need to be made, all of that coming up. And we are at the cusp of the season where we can run ourselves ragged and we can absolutely lose our sense of contentment. And strangely, it'll be through some of the things that we love most. If we love cooking, then we're going to cook ourselves so silly that we're going to lose our contentment. We're not going to enjoy it anymore. We may love to go shopping, and we may love buying presents, but we're going to do so much of it, worry so much about it, we're going to lose any contentment that it can bring into our lives. We deserve this. We have been promised this. And we should embrace it. We should grab onto it, especially as we're approaching this holiday season. That we should have a holiday season that's not only full of fun and relationships, all of that, but also one that is filled with a sense of contentment. To be like the Apostle Paul, I have learned in whatever circumstances I am in, I have learned to be contented because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It's a promise, and all we have to do is reach out for it and grab it. But how do we do that? Well, there's lots of things we could be doing, lots of things we probably should be doing in order to feel this contentment in our hearts, but here's just a couple that I think we absolutely need. How do we find contentment? How do we feel contented in our giving, in our relationships here at the church? How do we feel contented in our homes and in our work? All these different aspects of our lives. And one key, and I think Paul is a great example of this, is don't ever be willing to settle for too little. A lot of times, contentment eludes us because we are willing to settle for so little in life. The mediocre, the okay, even the bad. And we're willing to settle for that, and we wonder why contentment never comes our way. Well, I believe real contentment comes when we're able to reach for the highest and the best. We see this over and over again in the life of Christ and in his teachings. But just to illustrate, imagine the parents who are sitting and their teenage daughter brings home her report card from high school. And they open the report card, and there they see 3 F's and a D and a C. And of course, they're upset at that, but that doesn't compared to how upset they're about to be, because right then their daughter says, Mom, Dad, you've taught me well. I'm a good Christian person. And like the Apostle Paul, I know this isn't a great report card, but I've learned to be content in all things. So I am content with this report card. And you can imagine you think they'd be angry at the report card. They would be angry, the parents would be, at that idea of being contented with so little. So much less than you are capable of. And that's something I think that contentment can elude us, because we fool ourselves into thinking we are giving our highest, we are giving our best, but we are not. And in teachings of Jesus, we see this in the parable of the talents. Jesus talks about a master who leaves, and he leaves his 3 servants with money, and they're supposed to take care of that money. And two of them invested, you know, they trade, and they double the master's money. And the third is so scared of the master that all he does is bury him in the ground. Doesn't reach for the highest, doesn't reach for the best. And of course, he is the one who is condemned in all things to reach for our highest and our best. And if we are working on that, if we're doing that in our relationships, I'll tell you one thing, a relationship that we're not contented with, maybe not everything is the way it should be. Maybe it's a sibling that we are feuding with. Maybe it's a spouse. Or maybe it's a friend we haven't talked to in a while. And we wonder, have I given this relationship my highest and my best? If we have, then good. We can be content with that. I have done everything I need to do. I can be content with where this relationship is. But if we haven't, that gives us something to work on, some talents that we can put to use in our life. Make that relationship better and better. I'll tell you this. You all know this. I don't have to tell you this, but I experience it so regularly. It's such a reliable indicator of how I feel about my day. So when I leave the office at the end of the day, whether or not I am contented really depends on how much I have given of myself in that day. If I have given my highest and my best, and I've gotten nothing accomplished, and everything has gone badly, and I've had negative encounters, if I have given my best, I feel content. But if I've had a wonderful day where everything's been great, everything's been going well, and I don't give my highest and my best, even if it's been a great day and good things have been happening, I can't find that contentment. I absolutely believe our highest and our best, that is what we need in order to feel good, in order to feel contented. And of course, that has to do with our giving as well. The way we give of ourselves, not just our money, but also the way we give of ourselves each and every day. Are we willing to do the highest? Are we willing to do the best? And when we do, we can begin to feel that contentment if we choose. If we choose. That's one question for us on this day and every day. So when it comes to giving, when it comes to relationships, when it comes to work, when it comes to ourselves, taking care of ourselves, our health, all of these things, are we giving our highest and our best? Is that something we are willing to do, or are we willing to settle for the false contentment that can come from, all F's, but, you know, I'm content, so I'm not going to worry about it. Let's quit fooling ourselves and let's start giving our highest and our best in all things. There's another thing we can do as well. That first step, giving our highest and best, well, that's something we can do. I know lots of folks who do that, but I know that these folks who give their most, who give their utmost, the highest and the best, and boy, they do that every day. And I see it. I know you're out there. You all are. Gosh, what a wonderful congregation we have and group of people that are willing to do this. Not settle. Absolutely not settle. Always giving their best. Always putting the best foot forward. And yet still not content. Because we put off that contentment until tomorrow. You know, we do this all of our lives. It's an old story, right? I'm going to be content. I'm going to be happy when I get out of high school and I get on to the next thing and I move out of my parents' house. Then I'm going to be contented. Or I'm going to be contented when I finally get my degree and get that first job. Or no, it's not the first starter job. It's when I get done with that job and get on to the next job. Then I will find contentment. Oh, no, once I'm in a relationship. No, once I'm really in the middle of my career, then I'll find contentment. No, once I'm retired, then contentment will be mine. And of course, we know that we never, ever reach it in that way. Contentment isn't something that can simply live out into the future. Contentment is something that can and should be ours here and now. And it's so easy to put it off, to wait until tomorrow. But contentment is a present tense word. The willingness to be contented here and now. It's always easy to look forward, think, oh, contentment, that's where it's going to be. Or to look back and think, oh, that's when I was contented, or that's when I could have been. My father always has loved the poems of A.E. Housman. And when I went to the fair with my son last month, I went to the Texas Fair, and I thought about this A.E. Housman poem that my father used to read. And I think it speaks to this idea of contentment and the difficulty of finding it at any moment in our lives. It's just a short little poem. It says, when first my way to fair I took, few dimes to spend had I. And long I used to stand and look at things I could not buy. Now times are altered. If I care to buy a thing, I can. The dimes are here, and here's the fair. But where's the lost young man? Unable to find contentment in our youth. Unable to find contentment when we are older. How difficult it can be. And I'll tell you, one of the lessons of contentment that we learn is actually it is as we look back. And we think on those times, oh gosh, we knew that contentment would be ours someday. And we were back in that first entry-level job. Or we were back in that first funny little apartment that we lived in. Or we were back in the very first days of a relationship. And the relationship held such promise, we thought, for the future. And now we look back at those times when we were working on the degree, when we were struggling to get into a bigger place. And those days take on sort of a golden hue. How beautiful they are, and how easy it is for us to see. We had all the ingredients for contentment right then. How beautiful those days were, how wonderful they were. It's a lesson for us here and now today to think and to remember that yes, someday we will be looking back at this moment, right now, and we will think how wonderful it was. And why couldn't I feel it? Why couldn't I feel that sense of contentment that Paul talks about, that Christ promises us? One thing we may learn, we may come to see, is that as we look back in these difficult times in our lives, that we actually had all the ingredients for contentment during those times, we realize that as we thought back then that once we got done with the struggle, we could be content. Right? The struggle. Once it's over, then we will find contentment. But what we learn is that we can find contentment in the midst of the struggle. Yesterday, all over the country, and today, once again, all over the country, football teams are going to be gathered, and they're going to get the ball, and they're going to run it up and down the field. And we wonder, is that the point of it all? Is the point of the game to get a ball up and down the field the most times? Well, if that were the point, then I could steal a ball and I could run over to the field. I could do that at night. Run up and down the field with the ball all on my own. I could score as many points as I like. Of course, that's not the point of the game. The point of the game, the beauty of it, the reason so many of us here love it, it's not the up and down the field that we love. It is the struggle. All of our sports, that's why sports is such a beautiful metaphor for life. Every sport is a struggle. To push yourself, to join with others, and if you are wise, to find contentment in that struggle. Can find contentment in those early difficult days. To find contentment later on in our lives. To find contentment each and every day. How do we do it? How can we do it? Well, here are two quick and simple first steps for us to think about and to consider. First, look for contentment. Know that it is there in your life. Know that it is a promise of faith, and never, ever be willing to settle for too little. Reach for the highest and the best. Struggle each day for the highest and the best. And look for contentment in the midst of that struggle. Do it in your relationships, in your work, in your chores that you have each and every day. And as we do it throughout our lives, as we reach for the highest and the best, as we find contentment even in the midst of the struggle, as the days go on, as the end of our story nears, then we will be able to say, along with the Apostle Paul, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Let us bow in prayer. Loving God, thank you for giving us so many chances each day to fill our lives with great meaning. Lord, each day is a gift you give to us. Help us to see it as that, and help us to spend that day filling